guess this is probably directed to everybody, but you in particular, I forgot your name, spoke up really, is it either it felt somewhat uncomfortable, or didn't feel safe because what had just happened, and, you know, okay, we heard this very emotional open story from somebody, and we listened to her for a few minutes, she sits down, and what do we do from there? It's like, okay, we heard her story, how are we then to work with her and help her feel better about what is happening, get over what's happening? And I remember 2 years ago, I went to somebody who said a similar thing, that we come in here, we spend an afternoon dealing with these issues, you know, when you walk out, are you just going to forget about it? The opposite says the same thing in the slideshow, you know, we come, we feel good about ourselves for an evening, and then we go out and we can forget about it. Well, I said, I don't think that's necessarily true. That may be true for some people, but it's not true for me. When I walked out of the workshop 2 years ago, I kept thinking about it. And a group of us got together regularly, every Saturday, for most of the rest of the semester, and tried to and kept dealing with it. And I came back this year, because I'm still trying to deal with it. And if you want to work with you, if you want to get together and talk about it, so do that. And keep talking about it. And I mean, and that's part of the reason I'm here, to try and keep talking about it, even though I don't want to be here today. I just said before I came, I'd rather sit home and watch the football game and just take it easy and not have to deal with these issues. But that I shouldn't do that, even though I have the ability to do that. I'm in a position where I can't forget about all this stuff. A lot of you can't. You have to live with 24 hours a day for your entire life. And that sometimes I should try and make myself do what I can to feel what you do the best I can and not run away from it. Part of the reason that I'm here now. Yes, it is scary, but if you don't open up some, you're not going to get a lot out of this workshop, and if you can't keep doing more after here, you can go and talk about it and see if you want to talk about it further after today. Okay? Any other questions or comments?
Maybe that had an impact. Maybe I was feeling more confident about expressing.
me just say, safety works in a strange way. Sometimes you don't even, sometimes you're not conscious of the fact that you are guilty. When my friend, my woman friend in San Francisco, one day she turned to me and started attacking me. I mean, she was just coming at me, just verbally, just really going at it. And I was sitting there trying to figure out why I'm being attacked. What did I do? And I couldn't hear what I had done through the words that she was expressing. And then it dawned on me, she was talking about how she had been mistreated at the hands of the other relationships that she had been in before me. I represent the gender. I also represent safety because I'm her boyfriend. And so because I represent, because I'm safe, she can now express this stuff. And so she uses me. And me, by not taking it personally, understanding that this is a gender thing, she goes for it and I'm sitting there with her and I don't run away and I don't defend myself because there's really nothing to do. When a black person, when a white person decides to have a relationship with a black person, friendship, at some point you cannot have a black friend and not have that black friend talk about racism. If they are your friend, they have to talk about it. They have to. And sometimes they're going to pick on you because you have made it safe. And we really need to tell white people about what's going on with us. We really need to direct it at you. And so when you become our friend and when you provide some safety, we're going to blow up and attack you. And so what you need to know then is that when this black person attacks you, you can feel honored that now the relationship is really going somewhere. This marks the fact that, oh, they feel safe with you. Yeah. Now you, if you, when that black person comes out of that tirade and storming and banging and shouting and spitting and cussing, when they come out of that and you're still there, and you haven't run away, you bond. You got a real friendship there. So the attack means that now you're getting something. What we normally do is run away. Just when I thought the relationship was going well, they're attacking me. That attack means that you get ready to come close to me. It's another way of looking at it. So one of the things of doing a workshop is to try to get you to deal with black anger, be able to listen to it, and not take it so personal, but knowing that it's something that we have to do, we have to get it out. We're walking around trying to love our lovers, hug our children, do our turn papers, write our thesis, go to work, get some exercise while struggling with anger, rage, hopelessness, frustration, impotence, just going nuts inside, just churning around all the time. That means we gotta jump through every hoop that you have to jump through in this university to get out of this university. And you have emotions as well. But then we have this thing, this layer of stuff on top that we have to negotiate with. It becomes very difficult to be very soft and gentle things. I mean, looking at black humor, looking at some black guys playing, I mean, I love that humor because that's the humor I grew up with. It is hysterical, though. The humor comes in waves. It comes so fast. There's very few words, but it cuts right to the punchline immediately. And then the punchline, nothing to lead up to the punchline. The punchline from another black person comes in after that punchline, then another punchline. And you cry, and you laugh, and your stomach hurts, and you can't catch your breath. It's so intense. But white friends that have been with me in these situations, they are exhausted in 2 hours. They just, Jesus, and they can't get a word in edgewise. Because we need to talk so much. We've got so much stuff in there. So our humor comes in with vengeance, power. Power is your being able to just sit there, you don't have to know what to say, just be there. I hear you. And whatever a black person says, a black person says, my experience in America is this. And what you need to do is put a period at the end of their statement and accept it. what white people do was say, this is my experience in America. Or, this is my experience in Michigan. You put a comma at the end of our statement. And then you put but, comma, but. And then you're getting ready to disagree. You say, you know, I basically agree with what you said, but, comma, but. Now, this enrages us. Because basically you're getting ready to, you said, I basically agree with what you said, and now you're about to disagree with what we said. But that insults black people's intelligence, for one thing, because you're lying. You don't agree. When a woman says, this is what it's like for me to be a woman at the University of Michigan. So when a woman says that to us, men, we have to put a period at the end of her statement. This is fact. This is her experience. And I can't disagree. There's nothing to debate. I can't debate what she says her experience is. Her experience is her experience. I have to accept that as being fact. Learn from that. Go from there. The bottom line is her statement. The bottom line is my statement. My experience is such and such. Now, the other part of this, I need white males. I want you to speak up. I want you to become involved. White males do have a tendency to do something we call white analog thinking. They'll think about somebody will say, this happens to me, or this happens to me, and a white person will sit there and say, they'll think about it happening to them, and they can't visualize that happening to them, and therefore it doesn't happen to anybody. Can't happen to me, it doesn't happen to anybody. We know that although we're in this room, we're all experiencing this room in very different ways. If the sexism can be running, I can be up here saying something really sexist, and all the women can be shut down, upset, looking at each other, you know? They're not saying nothing, but they know. They know. And all the men are sitting in the room saying, all right, you're having a good time. And oblivious to it. And all the women are upset. They got theirs detectives. Black people, we see racism operating, and all the white people are just having a ball. Somebody else, what you said when you were
My name is Andrea. Do you still want to know? I'm having really, really big block right now. And especially when you were talking about black anger, and when Darren was talking about being afraid of black men. And I need to work on something. And if I can't work on this, I can't go past it. I mean, just set a wall. And I don't want to like make this all messy, and, you know, but I feel like I need to talk about it here. If I know I haven't really discussed it in this way.
Tell us your full name.
Yes, my name is Andrea Goldstein, and I'm from New York, and my my ancestors are from Eastern Europe, Jews. And I need to work, how do I do this?
Just say what you need to work, what's your concern.
Okay, when you were talking about black anger, immediately an experience went right through me, which was being the focus of that anger at a very young age, being a young woman, 17 years old, and being at gunpoint and knifepoint by a very angry man who was black, who was hating himself or hating women or hating white women or hating white men, hating everything, and doing it through me in a violent sexual way. Yeah, and I feel like, and I haven't.
Yeah, slow down, stop. You don't have to talk, just slow down for a second. Slow down. Can you hold my hand? Have you been close to any black man since then?
Yeah,
I love black men. I love black men. I'm sick and tired of, like, of, that's, I mean, that's sort of what I said right afterwards, you know? I mean, it's sort of like, you know, it feels more of, like, self-blame, like, okay, I'm a woman, so therefore this is my fault, you know, because I am dirty and I am, you know, a temptress, or I am, you know, leading people on, and I'm a white woman, so therefore, I mean, yeah, sure, I mean, you know, someone's going to be mad, you know, because look what, you know, my parents do, look what, you know, look at their position in society. I mean, yeah, someone's got to be pissed off. I just got in the line of fire. But I didn't, I mean, I think that that fire, and I understand, not understand, but I can recognize that that fire is there, you know?
Okay. I think you need to express your anger before you forgive.
I think so. I mean, yeah, it felt, you know, it felt, yeah, it didn't feel entirely real, and it's not, yeah, it's not just black, but, it's, yeah, I don't know what to do.
Your fabulous. What do you want to tell these guys? What do you want to tell them? Don't have to take care of them. Don't have to worry about it.
I don't want to deal with the second one because I told him.
You never have to put up with any violence from anybody. Anytime. You don't have to put up. You guys are always coming.
All I want to say is I'm sorry. You know, I'm sorry that you hate me. I'm sorry that, you know, I bring out so much rage and hatred in you. What, you know, and I have a hard time with the anger part, you know. I know it's there, but,
you know. Let's go around, bond, to get in the front door.
Right.
Things that don't seem connected, but that would become apparent to you that they are. Are you Jewish?
Yes, I'm Jewish.
Okay. Let's go. Right. Jewish. I'm a Jew.
I'm a Jew.
Proud Jewish woman.
I'm a proud Jewish woman. I feel much more in touch with being a woman than being a Jew. My last name is Goldstein, but there's, I mean, I know. It's not like a, you know.
Boys were going to beat up this Jewish boy one day, and I stepped in. He was my friend. I stepped in, and I stopped him.
classmates that come in. They want support for their institutions. They set up their institutions because the laws were passed that couldn't be farmers, and that money handling is considered dirty, so we'll make the Jews deal with that. So the Jews would deal with it. And the ruling class would continue exploiting the masses down there so badly that it got to such a point that the masses about to then go into revolt. Or, as they begin to go into revolt, the ruling class would tell the masses, Jews are the ones doing it too. So the masses would attack the Jews. And then the ruling class would withdraw their support from their institutions. And so the Jews would be off and on the run to another country. And the next country would say, yes, come on in, we'll take you in. And they would set up their institutions. And the process would start all over. I'm a Jew.
Can't homosexuality. You know, it was taken hostage by, you know, an angry person who, I don't know what to do with it. I don't know, like, how to forgive that person with all of myself. I mean, forgive, you know, but with all of me, how do I get back what I
thought,
what I had,
what
was mine, what I
didn't
think.
You have to take full pride in being a woman. You have to never accept anything less than absolutely everything. And this is something that I fiercely promise never again to accept anything less than absolutely everything.
I fiercely promise never to accept anything less than absolutely what I deserve. I never again will accept anything less than what is absolutely mine.
I'm a woman.
I'm a woman.
No, Paul, don't be polite.
My power's done for you.
Well, put it from down there.
I'm a woman. I'm a woman.
Oh, really? I'm a woman!
I'm a woman!
Beautiful. That is power. That is power. glad that people are thank you. Get an honest hand. I promise you nothing will happen bad while you're in this room. Just touch a little bit of something, but I can't solve problems. I can just lend some direction to which direction will solve the problem. Taking, you lose your power when you get violated by the situation that happened to her. She gets her power back by taking full, realizing a full humanity. Sitting in her sisterhood, sitting in the womanhood, and feeling great about it. Because those actions and those incidents, they make being a woman awful. You gotta get right back on the horse. The horse makes you off. You gotta come right back and say, I'm okay. A bad incident with a bunch of white people is very important. You need to get with some good white folks who are my buddies. The problem for many white people is that you've grown up isolated from us. You've been told that 90%, 98% of white Americans will go from cradle to the grave, never having anything negative happen to them at the hands of black people. The majority of you will never have anything bad happen to you by a black person. So that means that all the negative and all the ugly things and the fear that you have of us is based on hearsay. You have been spoon-fed horror stories. Unless you get lucky, get in a situation where you can have a relationship with black people, where you say where you have good relationships, you'll have bad relationships, but you'll be able to strike a balance. But when you've been spoon-fed hearsay and you're isolated from us, and then you come up to a negative experience, such as she had, it just aha, it confirms all of the stuff that you've heard. But when you get to have relationships, then you get to have bad ones and good ones, but you strike a balance. And we're not a blank slate. Like Yaga said, our minds were closed quite a long time ago. We got imprinted, impacted. When your mother or father tells you that there are people that you shouldn't be around, there are parts of town you shouldn't go in, but they're out there to hurt you. When a person is told this at 5, 6 years old, a young child, this is terror. Real terror. And that white child will go for the rest of their lives bouncing off this terror. That terror will dictate to you where you're going to go to school, who you're going to party with, who you're going to talk to, where you're going to live, where your children are going to be. Because you never have an opportunity to get over the terror. Because isolation keeps it glued together. That's the number one horror story for white America. Because you've basically grown up white. White in a white environment would not be multicultural influences and joys. Those of us who live in a national, that is wonderful. The more different people we can have. I mean, it's really a proud thing on the night that you go into a bar or to a club and you're 9 people and nobody's from the same country. That's fun. You really feel like you feel healthy. You feel like you're doing it right. Feels just something you can't give up. And then you come back to this country, white folks over there, black folks over there, going back and forth, you know, you feel a little crazy, a little healthy, going back and forth someplace else, you know, I feel a little sick. I believe black folks over there, I don't like white folks. agree to it. You can't be a victim unless you cooperate with the victimization. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on you. I'll only be a victim because I allow you to keep victimizing me. Black people cooperate with their victimization. We cooperate with it. Women cooperate with the victimization. Any comments or questions?
Well, with that idea, how do you not...
You gotta stand up.
What's your name?
Dave.
With that idea of, you know, for them once, you know, shame on you, for them twice, shame on them, how do you not blame? You know, it's kind of like.
Not blame who?
What?
I'm just
well,
saying
just
exactly what it is you mean.
Well, the victim idea, you know, that people caught their own victimization, is that implying that there's some sort of fault?
Well, you gotta cooperate too. You gotta. Just like we put up with things that we don't have to put up with. Women put up with relationships and guys who really are jerks. But they'll find some part of that guy that's really nice. And they'll use that as a justification by hanging on to that. It might be good sex, or it might be the guy's popular and everybody else wants to be with him, but he's with me, so I hang on a little while, or just all kinds of stuff. We put up with stuff that we don't have to put up with. And then there's a certain amount of stuff that we do have to put up with. You gotta play this game to get out of this university. There's certain rules you just have to do. When you get out of here, you will give up those rules. You will put on dresses, and you will, you're gonna get in a corporation. There are certain things you're going to have to do. We have lost the fine line as to where we lose our individuality and where we become incorporated and stamped. March in line with everybody else. We're not trying to lay blame anywhere, but we're just trying to get black people have to take back the power. That we're not gonna sit around while white people are trying to change their attitudes and give us some assistance. There are things we can do. Louis Farrakhan says it real well. There's a lot we can do. So we don't have to sit around waiting for the victimizer of a person who